It is only 6 months ago that we introduced the S5. That is a machine that basically confirmed our leading position in the market, and I bet you believe me in that statement. But the real important issue there, and I felt pretty groundbreaking, was the announcement of a collaboration with, at the time, 9 large material supplying companies. Ever since, we made enormous progress in this collaboration. Be aware that most of the competitors, the companies that produce 3D printers, have a closed material system. We, as Ultimaker, don't like closed for many reasons. Price is too high, it locks you in. But most importantly, it denies the essential characterization of 3D printing, and that is that the choice of material is leading in what you want to do with 3D printing, what part you want to build, the properties that you want to build. Everything is determined by materials. Now, there is a slight little problem with materials. People tell me that there are about 70,000. And 70,000 materials are there for a very good reason. They give you the properties, they give you the opportunities to create new applications. But we, as a 3D printing company, we need to support that. It's not sufficient to simply say, we're open. It's not sufficient to say you can put any material in there. There is far more to it than just saying we're open. And that's what I would like today to announce. We're going to introduce with Cura 3.6 the marketplace. And in the marketplace, you will find print profiles. And print profiles determine, in the end, the reliability of a 3D printing process. So what we're talking about is the reliability that if you push the button in the evening, you are sure that the next morning there is a part that you can bring to your customer, that you can show to your boss, that you can work with again, that you can iterate on. This reliability is crucial for the current market. We made a big change. It's incredible how we currently present our machines, the companies we're working with. I'm really impressed with that. But it's all telling because in the market we made this change from people looking into technology. Would it work? Would 3D printing work? That was only 2-3 years ago. Today, I'm talking to people simply saying, hey, it's a simple tool, it must work. Please get it right. And to get it right, we introduced the marketplace. The marketplace is made available to almost 3 million people in the world using Cura. And what these people can do here is find print profiles. A print profile is, in essence, a darn busy job. It'll take you about 6 months to make a print profile right. In Cura, you have about 350 settings. And to get it right to the point where you can actually use a material and have this reliability of pushing the button in the evening and making sure that the next morning it is working, that's a lot of work. What we did before we reached out to the large material supplying companies is that we were saying we had to help them. And we created software called the Print Profile Assistant, which helps you to create a print profile from 6 months to within a week. And that has been a major breakthrough in collaborating. And today, we can announce the first 1, 2, 3, 4. There was a fifth. It's a pity, but Owens Corning couldn't be here today. 5 companies that we will introduce the marketplace with. And in this marketplace, in this case DSM, you can find the print profiles that you can use to use a certain material. So if you choose to use a certain DSM material in this case, because you like the properties, because there is already a long relationship with DSM in this case, then simply go to Cura, download the print profile, and you're basically good to go. Now that is a serious breakthrough, I feel, for the industry. In the end, the choice of material is leading. And when I'm saying that, I'm actually lying a little bit, because what is really leading is the property of the material. And immediately, once we announced the collaborations with the likes of you, our larger customers started to reach out, and they were saying, hey, can you help us find the right properties? Can you help us find transparent material, or can you help us find stronger material or more flexible material? So what is currently happening is because we open up this entire ecosystem of material suppliers, we're not just opening up a market, we're not just opening up access to all sorts of material, we open up a market of new applications. And today I'm honored to have four of our partners here. Thank you very much for being here. What I would like to do is simply first make a quick round where you introduce your material, tell a little bit about the applications you envision, and then the next round we'll talk a little bit about the future, what you see happening in let's say 1 to 3 years from now. Jeroen, would you be willing to start?
Yeah. So we introduced our PET carbon fiber filled material into one of the first two materials in the program with Ultimaker. Let's say it's an entry level construction material which is easy printable and which gives you the opportunity to print parts with a higher stiffness and a lower specific weight. The second one is a glass fiber filled PP, 30% filled. PP is the second largest material after LDPE. And it's not an entry level material. So and this is exactly the point, Paul, which you were addressing. I think if you we also got, for example, feedback from our PETC CF from the market, and some of the users say, well, it's not so easy to handle because we have to prepare the build plate, the glass build plate, because otherwise it won't stick or whatever. And this is exactly the situation. If an end user needs a certain material for a certain application, he will be able to manage to handle this to make a useful print of it.
Yeah. David.
Thank you very much. So we have three materials that we're releasing. PETG, so a universal material that works quite well with the Ultimaker S5. And then two flame retardant polyamide 666 materials that take advantage of our excellent flame retardant. And one being glass fiber reinforced that really works well with the CC core.
And what do you see in application, fields of applications that you're currently working on?
So I guess actually your Ford video fits quite well, where a balance of manufacturing aids and then real end use parts. So the flame retardant material is being pulled by customers that really want to produce parts with Ultimakers.
Got you. Patrick.
Yeah, we'll launch four new materials in the Cura system. I will highlight two. One of those new polyamide carbon fiber, which is used for structural components and can be used as end-use parts. And we have Arnital HT. It's the first high-temperature thermoplastic copolyester, which can handle 190 degrees continuous. And it's very chemical resistant. I think this really will leap applications toward end-use applications.
Ernst.
Yeah, okay, so we in DuPont we have Hytrel, elastomeric material. It's my opinion, reinforcer. Finally, the 3D printed part has a better performance than an injection molding part, because the injection molded part with all the weld lines would crack if I would bend it in that case. So again, objective is real serial parts. So it can be boots, bellows, CVG boots, mainly automotive. Hytrel is well known there, but also air ducts, which are typically blow molded. And people typically look to injection molded components. I believe that blow molding is an extremely interesting area for Hytrel 3D printing. And then we have an unreinforced nylon in Cura, and we're in the pipeline. And as we announce here on the Formnext, there will be a carbon fiber reinforced nylon.
This gives you a flavor of the materials that we're currently introduced. This will never stop. Virtually every day nowadays, I get people out of particularly machine industry literally saying, Mr. Heiden, what we're currently doing is go through the bill of material of our machines, see, first of all, what parts we can place from metal to plastic, and then immediately after that, what can we do to 3D print it? And this has been a necessity before we could actually start. That's a sort of kickoff for the future, talking about what would actually be a huge market. Do you have any value on that?
So I have values, but I cannot share that detail. But it's big. But I mean, if you look, whoever sells materials on the market, except packaging, let's keep that aside, can basically come down a little bit to probably similar numbers, maybe between 15 and 20%. So everyone is going to be affected by that. So 15 to 20% of the raw material granule pellet sales will become an addressable market within the next 10 years for additive manufacturing or FLM. Yeah. So there's a big thing in there. Yeah. So,
Patrick,
yeah.
You're busy in transport. Yeah. I'm currently feeling that automotive is pretty much leading the way.
Yeah.
What do you expect automotive to do in the forthcoming period?
Yeah, I think in transportation, everything is on lightweight, be more sustainable, but also predictable. And so I think these are big drivers which enable 3D printing. What we see is that there's enormous pull if you really can help people with the application, but bringing performance, but also the reliability in, and then with the printers, with the software, with the materials, that you really can guarantee that you can do something with the material what they also expect. I think that's, for us, the real first step to move into the market. Otherwise, it doesn't make sense. You keep prototyping. We need to get out of this prototyping and go into end-use parts and reliable and on a sustainable way.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah, maybe I can add something to that. What we learned from automotive is that you have all these technical readiness levels and manufacturing readiness levels, and you call how you call them. But I think they have to go. Automotive will go step by step. So, and what our information is that, like Patrick says, the next level will be functional prototyping. So, and we often get questions about, okay, we would like to have a material to print with which is the same as we now injection mold with. And of course that, I mean, if you are able to deliver that, it's a lucky shot. So you have to look at the properties and the end properties and have to look at the design of the part. So everything comes together. So I think it will take some time to really go into small series production because you cannot force these giant organizations into that.
Yeah.
But of course, they're thinking about it and they're working at it. So that's very good.
It's something, David, that I also discussed with you. In the beginning, I had the feeling that particularly the chemical companies were in there in 3D printing just to protect their mass production. I tend to see a change now towards functional and even low volume.
So maybe just moving away from automotive, so E&E electronics and electrical products, we would have pull for Exolit to where people actually want to produce maybe not 10,000 parts.
It's already happening, you're saying.
Correct, yeah.
Yes.
So, yes. And so they would be very excited by the S5.
Can you tell about a little example, perhaps?
So we make flame retardant grade filaments, so they'd be making a variety of, could be simple parts for oil rig type applications of electrical enclosures and whatnot. Not getting too specific, but they are looking to take advantage of an S5 and a CC core where they, for example, we have a glass fiber reinforced flame retardant material, and so they want to make products with it.
Thanks.
So it's happening. Yeah.
Okay. I think this is just a starting point. I think it's important. To me, it's extremely important. I think this more or less shows the way for the industry, a collaboration with the leading material companies, 3D printing companies. I'd love to talk about all the advantages of FDM versus SLA and SLS. We'll talk about that later.